Usually I get about 11 people for my talks, so I think the whiff of scandal perhaps has brought people in, I don't know. But yeah, crazy cameramen and profligate photographers. We got something like 2 million or maybe even 2.5 million photographic items now in the Sir George Grey Special Collections, and about 5% of them have been digitized, so you can see we've got quite a way to go. But they can be seen online on the Heritage Images database, which is that. And in addition to that, there are around 133,000 photographs that we've digitized from the bound volumes of the Auckland Weekly News supplement from 1898 to 1945. And then there's another 35,000 or so New Zealand graphic and ladies' journal images from 1890 to its closure in 1913 that have been digitized and appear on the same database. So there's something like 300,000 images that you can see online as part of the Heritage Images database. And no doubt, as photograph librarian, you'd expect me to say just how wonderful all these photographs are. And that's true. There are some superb images amongst the collection. This one is by Herbert Deverell of Ohinemutu Pa around about 1876. And if we zoom in a little bit, he's managed to photograph virtually everybody in the village, I think. They're all lined up on the banks of the river here, sitting on the roofs. Quite a phenomenal photograph. But what I find just as interesting is that every time you pick up a photograph, more often than not, there's quite an intriguing story that's lurking behind the photographers themselves. New Zealand is, for want of a better description, a nation of immigrants. And in the 19th century, Pākehā immigrants had to be especially hardy. And the rigors of life at the frontiers of Western colonization threw up some interesting characters, and photographers in particular. And many early photographers saw the profession as a means of making easy money from a captive audience. And whilst that was true to some extent, as time went on, the reality became quite different. Many photographers found that they had to switch between professions to make a living, or they had to work in tandem with other vocations, and bankruptcy was a constant hazard. And when debts became too much, more than a few took the photographer's way out, drinking a cocktail of darkroom chemicals. And many of their stories can be gleaned from the pages of papers past, of course, which contains millions of pages from New Zealand's historic newspapers. And it's from the newspapers that we know that Christchurch photographer Charles Henry Manning left a series of scribbled notes on pieces of cardboard when he downed a glass of silver nitrate mixed with whiskey in 1895. One note read Fated Studio, which was a reference to the fact that the studio had previously been owned by a guy called Niels Peter Schurup, who'd actually also died by his own hand. And then there was another note that he wrote that said, New Brighton Cemetery, please, because he wanted to make sure, that he ended up in the right graveyard. This is one of Manning's photographs. We can tell, obviously, it's got his name on the bottom of the mount. It's a cabinet card, so it's about postcard size today. And there's a report of his death, as it appeared in the newspaper here. And then this portrait is actually of Sir Aparana Nata. And how it got into our collections is interesting in itself. It's quite a convoluted story. Nata was an admirer of Sir George Grey, and in 1894 he asked if Sir George would support the establishment of 3 scholarships for Maori boys at Te Ote College in Hawke's Bay. And when Richard John Duncan wrote to Nata congratulating him on his suggestion, Nata sent Duncan a copy of his portrait, which Duncan then forwarded to Sir George Grey, and Sir George pasted it into his scrapbook. And then when Sir George gifted his library at Kawau to the people of Auckland in 1882, the scrapbook and this photograph came to the library. And the signature on the letter to the right there of the photograph is another letter that's held in Sir George Grey Special Collections, which was written by Aparana Nata. This was how Parnell Rise looked in 1876 when the government photographer Herbert Deverell, that man again, visited Parnell during a tour of the North Island to collect photographic images for the 1876 Philadelphia exhibition. And Deverell used a huge wet plate camera that took 15 inch by 12 inch glass plates. So that's about 40 centimeters by 30 centimeters, so huge. And this explains, the size of the negative explains to some extent why his photographs are so exceptionally crisp and detailed, but his equipment would have been particularly heavy and cumbersome. And if I actually just go down a bit, just ignore that for a minute. That's not the only thing that's heavy and cumbersome. Because enlargers hadn't been invented, he printed his mammoth plate negatives as contact prints, which meant that the glass plates, or the prints from the glass plates, are the same size as the glass plates. And then these prints were pasted onto even bigger pieces of card and bound into an album. And so this is the album, and I can tell you it's not only enormous, it's awkward to carry, and it's exceedingly heavy as well. So when people say, "I'd like to look at the Deverell album, please," we say, "Sure about that." I'll just nip back up here. So that's Parnell Rise again here. Railway Bridge, Stanley Street, Swan Inn, Maori Hostelry, Beach Road when the beach was here, and the Strand when there was a Strand. Part of Deverell's remit when he was photographing around New Zealand was to record numerous works of public improvement in New Zealand. So he's obviously taking Parnell Railway Bridge is the focus of his interest in this photograph here. And that was built between 1865 and 1866 as part of the Parnell to Drury Railway. We're going to come back to Deverell later, but in the meantime, if you note this cottage here, just above the Swan Inn and the railway line, we'll have a look at that later as well. We'll skip past me again because we don't need to see me. And this is how the same scene looked in this photograph by Henry Winkleman, which was taken on the 21st of March 1904. We're going to come back to Henry Winkleman again, but recognize the railway bridge, of course. The Swan Inn looks a bit different. The Maori Hostelry looks a bit different. The beach is gone. The Strand is there, but not really there. Parnell School up the road there. And so familiar elements, but what's particularly interesting as far as I'm concerned is this cottage, which is still there in 1904. And if we zoom in a bit, you can perhaps make out there's a signboard there in the shape of a circular saw blade, and you might just be able to see underneath that it says R. Leaf. We can't actually read the words underneath R. Leaf, but with access to the glass plate negative and a watchmaker's loop, I can tell you that it actually says saws sharpened, cut and hammered. So that then is the home of the Leaf family, who arrived in Auckland as part of the Albertland Nonconformist Settlement in 1862. And like many Albertlanders, the Leafs never made it beyond Auckland. Robert Leaf was a saw doctor, hence the sign, and Robert Leaf Jr. did good business as a photographer in Waterloo Quadrant from at least 1866. And his premises were probably those that the Daily Southern Cross described in 1868 as that odd structure used as a photographic studio, which must prove a great eyesore and obstruction to the magnificent view of the harbour to be obtained from the Government House grounds. So this is actually Robert Leaf, and it's actually a photographic portrait that's been painted over in oils, and you can tell it's a photo because that's the print there. They've not painted over the tablecloth or the chair or his hands. And this was a recognized technique of the period, but you had to be reasonably good at it. because otherwise it tends to look a bit naive, as it does in this instance. I don't know whether I should suggest that it was painted by his mother, Eliza Elizabeth Leaf, who's also a photographer and an artist, but that's a possibility. And it comes actually from one of his descendants. Robert Leaf is mentioned in the diaries of Peter Robertson that form part of New Zealand manuscript 1192 that we have in our manuscript collections here at the library. And I've extracted a couple of entries from the diaries. The first one is for the 7th of February 1873, which we should note is just before Valentine's Day. And here, Peter Robertson has written, "Posted Valentine to Janet." Clearly, Janet didn't have Robert Leaf on her radar, because on the 3rd of March 1873, he's noted in his diary, rather laconically, "At store in morning, busy upstairs, went to Nielsen's, on the road home, overtook Janet Brown. She told me of just receiving a Valentine from Mr. Leaf, the photographer. It was the one I sent." So, disappointed in love. Long before Kiri Te Kanawa, there was Annie Leaf, Robert Leaf's sister. This is a portrait of her by Robert Leaf, and I'm assuming this is her stage gear, because she looks a bit flamboyant for day-to-day wear. And she was New Zealand's first internationally acclaimed opera singer. She married another photographer, William Henry Reid, and he died in the Leaf family's Parnell cottage, hence my interest in the cottage, in 1878. So that's the one I pointed out earlier. And that's confirmed by the death notice that appeared in the Auckland Star. So it puts it all in context and tells you who William Henry Reid's father was as well. Reid arrived in Auckland from London in 1860 on board the Jura, and he combined his photography with a variety of jobs. He was a gifted and versatile musician and entertainer, and he wrote his own songs in the form of locals. So he would pick on particular events that were in the news, and then he'd write a song about it. So there's even one about Sir George Grey, believe it or not. He had quite a reputation as an Ethiopian delineator. That means he was a blackface minstrel. And that was a surprisingly popular form of entertainment on the goldfields. And it was particularly popular, well-frequented by not just Pākehā, but also Māori, believe it or not. After a punch-up with his brother-in-law and former partner, Charles Henry Monckton, yet another photographer, he moved to the west coast of the South Island. He ran a hotel and undertaker's business in Stafford Town near Hokitika. And the hotel had its own stage where celebrities like... if I move down. Celebrities like Joe Small, in his role of the unfortunate man there, and Charles Thatcher performed. And then in the early 1870s, he opened a studio in Brown Street in Grahamstown. So this is an example of one of William Henry Reid's carte de visite. By the time of his death in 1878, he'd negotiated to buy a musical instrument business in Auckland. After he died, crates and crates of musical instruments kept arriving at the Auckland docks with his name on them. And I think the business was taken over by his brother, Fred Reid, and ultimately it became Lewis Eadie's. William Henry Reid's brother-in-law, we've already mentioned, Charles Henry Monckton, is perhaps New Zealand's most notorious photographer, so much so that photo historian Bill Main called him the bad guy of New Zealand photography. And although he was arrested in April 1884 and jailed for 2 years after marrying a 12-year-old girl, that wasn't the reason for his incarceration. In fact, until 1933, it was perfectly legal for a girl under 16 to marry, provided that she had the consent of a parent or guardian. What proved Monckton's undoing is the fact that in some bizarre, premeditated precursor to an enforced ménage à trois, the girl's sister, who was also Monckton's live-in lover, misrepresented herself to the Auckland Registrar as the girl's mother and overstated the girl's age. And so for his part in the charade, Monckton was convicted of making a false declaration under the 1880 Marriage Act. And the ensuing divorce case made legal history. So legal history seems to circulate around C.H. Monckton. The divorce was refused on the grounds that although Monckton's treatment of his teenage bride was grossly immoral and disgusting, it didn't amount to legal cruelty. Legal cruelty was the prerequisite for dissolution of a marriage at the time when initiated by the wife. This wasn't Monckton's first brush with the law, however. In 1862, he was released early from a three-month jail term imposed for operating an unlicensed grog shop and then skipping the country. And then in December 1863, he was arrested on board ship, deserting from the militia. And the sum of £86, 18 shillings and 10 pence halfpenny found on him was confiscated. We only know about that because he tried to claim it back. And then in 1882, in yet another legal test case, he stood trial for breaching the 1877 Fine Arts Copyright Act by copying a photograph of the Maori king, Tafia, without the authority of the owner, Elizabeth Pullman. And incredibly, the judge threw the case out on the grounds that the act was informal and inoperative, and therefore there was no copyright to infringe. And it took another 30 years for a workable copyright law to be put in place. This is an example of one of Monckton's photo mounts dating from 1866 when he had a studio in Princes Street, and it's really quite an impressive mount with a photograph of a Maori warrior and a cabbage tree, and really quite nice. And then on the other side of the screen we've got another well-known photograph of Wirramu Tamahana, which was taken at Tamahana's base at Waiharakeke in 1865, and it was taken by Monckton. There's a series of about three or four photographs which are noted by the local news, by the Daily Southern Cross, as being taken by Monckton. And intriguingly, we can name absolutely everybody in this photograph. So W.L.C. Williams, his brother-in-law, Joseph Clifton Firth, Wirramu Tamahana, Purai, Dr. Seth Sam, William Australia Graham. The only person we can't name is this chap here in the Tam O'Shanter. Put that down. Who the heck is he? And a few years ago, John Sullivan, who was then the photograph librarian at the Alexander Turnbull Library in Wellington, suggested to me that this was actually that bad guy, Charles Henry Monckton. And then a few months ago, I was going, like you do, going through our photograph collections again, and I came across this version of the photograph, which, same photo, nicely captioned. Again, we've got everybody named, but it's got an additional piece of information on here. It says that the name of the person in the Tam O'Shanter, well, not the name, but the person wearing the Tam O'Shanter is the photographer, name not known. So was that, or is this Charles Henry Monckton? Luckily, when he was released from prison in 1886, the Police Gazette thought to publish a description of him. And the description runs something like this. Nose, medium. Mouth, medium. Chin, medium. It did, however, say that he was 5'3". And if we run a line across from the top of his head, he's about half a head smaller than W.L.C. Williams. So I'm sort of tempted to think that this may well be Charles Henry Monckton. And then earlier this year, in my usual trawl of the internet to see if anything else has turned up about this chap, I came across this item on Tony Rackstraw's Early New Zealand Photographers blog. And there's a nice carte de visite, so that's about the size of a cigarette card, nice carte de visite portrait on the back of a London photographic company mount. And the London photographic company was the incarnation of C.H. Monckton from around about 1880. And somebody's written, "With best love," right above C.H. Monckton. So is this another portrait of Charles Henry Monckton? I just sort of put the other one next door, or next to it. There are some similarities, perhaps, but it's difficult to say. If this is Charles Henry Monckton and was taken in 1865, 1866, then he's 25 there, and this potentially could be 1880, so he should be 40 there, but I don't know. Perhaps it's stretching the imagination a little much, but... Interestingly, Monckton at one time crossed swords with Herbert Deverell, the chap who you'll remember took the 1876 photograph of Parnell Rise that we looked at earlier. And despite Deverell's expertise with the camera, he'll probably be best remembered for this statement, this advertisement, where he promises babies instantaneously. And quite conveniently, trams stop at door. Deverell is another of those photographers who succumbed to bankruptcy on a regular basis, and his photographic career began in Melbourne, and after at least one bankruptcy there in 1868, he was recruited by the New Zealand government to head up the photolithographic department in Wellington. And that all went very well until there was a process of restructuring, and he was made redundant, so there's nothing new under the sun. Setting up his own photographic studio in Wellington, he got into a price-cutting war with Monckton again and ended up bankrupt again, after which he found that selling life insurance was much more lucrative and more to his taste. And as resident secretary of the Melbourne-based Colonial Mutual Life Assurance Society, he oversaw the construction of the company's offices in Auckland in 1884-5. And you'll probably recognize them. This is them here. So you might just be able to make it out. It says Colonial Mutual. That's a photograph by James Douglas Richardson taken in 1927. And then the photograph in the top corner taken by Andrew Pettingill in the audience somewhere here in 2011 shows the building as it looks pretty much now. There's quite a few differences, I suppose, but the major difference, apart from all the buildings around it, are these two extraneous pieces of masonry which have disappeared in the intervening period. And understand that after the Napier earthquake in 1931, various buildings in Auckland had the structural makeover akin to the seismic rejigging that's going on at the moment. So they took down a lot of the problematic pieces of masonry. The most intriguing thing about Herbert Deverell, however, is that he started life under the name of Albert Edwin Eakins and changed his name to Herbert Deverell in 1862 or 1863. So if you read his father's will, it says something like, "And to my son, Albert Edward Eakins, now known as Herbert Deverell, I leave X." But why he changed his name to Herbert Deverell, I don't know, unless it was just a sort of advertising gimmick, I don't know. Anybody with any ideas, see me afterwards. Henry Winkleman, this is him here when he worked for the Bank of New Zealand, who took the 1904 photograph of Parnell Rise that I showed you earlier, is probably best known for his yachting photographs and his shots of the Auckland waterfront that he took from the masts of ships berthed at the wharves. And there are two Winkleman collections, in fact. Henry Winkleman bequeathed his maritime photographs to the Auckland Museum. And we've got a collection of around 1,700 glass plate negatives of Auckland streetscapes that the city librarian John Barr rather presciently purchased in 1928 at sixpence per negative. Interestingly, Henry Winkleman, despite his Germanic surname, was born in Bradford in the UK, and spookily, we share a birthday and a birthplace. 99 years apart, I might add. And he ended up in New Zealand purely because he followed his brother out here in 1878. And his brother, Charles Peter Winkleman, only came here to escape England on his release from prison for involuntary manslaughter. It sounds worse than it was, if you can have gradations of manslaughter. Charles Peter Winkleman built a homemade cannon, which he then proceeded to test fire on Guy Fawkes Night in 1876 or 1877, and during the process of which he managed to kill a school chum, and he then spent 6 weeks in prison. And I'm assuming that New Zealand's Chief High Court Judge Helen Winkleman is a descendant, although I don't know if she's aware of her ancestor's criminal background. This photograph is another typical example of a Winkleman shot, this one being taken from of the Auckland waterfront from the mast of the ship Thornley Bank on the 21st of March 1904. And it's a nice shot of the Queen Street Wharf and Queen Street and the original Britomart station and, yep, looking towards Mount Eden. Herbert Henry Vorley. He was one of those photographers who had several jobs. He combined photography with phrenology, and despite leading a humble existence on the West Coast, he came from quite a wealthy family. In fact, his aunt lived next door to Charles Dickens in London, and when she died in 1879, Vorley immediately left for England to claim his share of her £50,000 estate. And today, that's equivalent to something like $9 million if you go by the Retail Prices Index, or about $40 million if you look at average earnings. Either way, it was pretty substantial. This portrait on the bottom right there shows Herbert Henry's daughter, Frances Sharp Vorley, and she was named after Vorley's wealthy aunt, Frances Sharp, and was photographed on her fifth birthday, 16th of November, 1877. And it's one of a collection of 11 carte de visite portraits of Herbert Henry and Margaret Vorley's children that Auckland Libraries acquired in 2008. And intriguingly, each of the mounts has been defaced front and back to remove Vorley's name. But for some reason, they've done that, but they've left the inscription, which clearly shows the name of the child, including the surname Vorley. So another of those little mysteries, why did somebody vandalize these portraits? And then just on the left there is a phrenological chart of Sir George Grey, the sort of thing that Herbert Henry Vorley would have had access to as in his role as phrenologist. And this was drawn by Australia-based Pasquale Bassomo in 1891. And phrenology is the divination of temperament and character traits based on the study of the shape and size of the human skull. So all these little drawings are supposed to indicate what each part of the brain, I think, deals with. And this little bit here apparently relates to Sir George Grey's beer drinking capabilities. John McGarrigle. John McGarrigle ran the American Photographic Company in Auckland in the 1870s, and he promoted his studio as photographer, as you can see from this logo from the back of his photographs. He promoted the studio as photographers to the New Zealand and Mexican governments. Bit of an odd combination. He did produce a series of photographs for the Auckland provincial government in 1874 to promote immigration. So there's an element of truth to that aspect of the claim. But he was Irish and not American, and he never went anywhere near Mexico, as far as I can work out. Reputedly, he was the inventor of the flamethrower, an invention which, when rejected in turn by the Queensland and British governments, he then sold to the German military just in time for World War I. He certainly had plenty of experience of combustion. So this photograph shows the glass roof of his studio above Milne Choice's store in Queen Street. And this, the whole store was destroyed by fire, originating in McGarrigle's darkroom in September 1876. And then the following year, having left Auckland for Australia, McGarrigle's drapery store in New South Wales was wrecked when he knocked over a kerosene lamp. And the blaze also destroyed a large collection of negatives that he brought with him from New Zealand. And 100 or more of his negatives are actually in the Burton Brothers collection at Te Papa. And this is an example of one of those portraits that he did of Maori for the American Photographic Company. So I don't know whether it's this sort of thing that was destroyed in the fire, but the quality is so good, you know, you have to sort of weep wondering what on earth was destroyed in that fire. Another interesting photographer is Bruno Hamel. The regular question is, whatever happened to Bruno Hamel? He established a photographic studio in Auckland in 1858, and then in 1859 he was recruited by the visiting Austrian geologist Ferdinand Hochstetter to accompany his expedition into the central North Island. And as a photographer, he wasn't great. This is an example of his one of his photographs of the white terraces at Rotomahana. And both Hochstetter and Julius Haast had a good moan about him, but he did bring back a collection of 60 glass plate negatives from the Hot Lakes district, which permitted Aucklanders to see parts of New Zealand that very few of them had ever seen before. And then in 1861, Bruno Hamel abandoned his wife, his 18-year-old wife, and he went to Australia and disappeared. And then in 1866, his mother advertised for information about his whereabouts. And after her death in 1874, the family solicitor also tried to locate him, as he was now the principal beneficiary of a substantial estate in England. And that's the 1874 advertisement asking, does anybody know about him? Really quite interesting, because it gives you information about where he came from, what his grandfather's name was, the fact that he's... he'd come to New Zealand 16 years ago, so 1858, 16 from 1874. The other interesting thing that it says here is that having previously resided in Australia, and in actual fact, if you do a bit of digging, you'll find that he and his mother and father came out to Australia in the early 1850s, and his father was killed by a tree falling on the tent they were in, and they then went back to the UK. And Bruno Hamel's, I think it's his uncle, one of his relations was mayor of Tamworth, in the early 1800s, and I did contact the Stafford Archives office to see if perhaps they had a Bruno Hamel album, but they didn't know anything about their my favourite son of Tamworth, at least. And at this point, I used to say that nothing was ever heard of Bruno Hamel again, and then a while ago, searching on Trove, which is the Australian equivalent of Papers Pass, I came across a couple of adverts for B.L. Hamel playing the banjo in Toowoomba in 1877 and 1878. And we know that Bruno Hamel was musically inclined because of this advertisement in Lawrence's Auckland Registry Office Almanac in 1860, where he's advertising as a photographic artist, and immediately underneath that he'll repair and tune musical instruments. So was this Bruno Hamel turning up in Toowoomba after perhaps a stint of performing in the United States, if the name of the troupe can be anything to go by? I don't know. Still haven't been able to track him after 1878, or if that was him indeed. Another mystery photographer is Charles Burton Hoare. He was born in Manchester, and he and his family disembarked in Auckland in 1863, where he established a photographic partnership under the name of Hoare and Wooster, with premises, the Royal Photographic Rooms here on the corner of Vulcan Lane and Queen Street. Upstairs, of course, with skylights, so you get good natural light. You might just be able to make out there's a cabinet frame here with photographs on display for people in the street to view. And I think actually the entrance was down in Vulcan Lane. Papers Past tells us that he also was a bit of an athlete and ran foot races for money. And whilst he advertised as a photographer in the newspapers, a couple of his advertisements there, he was not as prolific in that respect as many of his contemporaries. And he seems to have filled the gap by using posters to announce his peregrinations. So this is a photograph that we acquired in the last 12 months or so, and it's a photograph of civilians and soldiers of the 12th Regiment standing on the veranda and balcony of the hotel at Narrowahia. I don't know whether you can make out this poster behind this chap's head here. If we enlarge that, you might just be able to see that it says something like CB Hoare photographer on there. So clearly he's touting for business using posters. And according to the New Zealand Herald, the 12th Regiment left Narrowahia for Napier on the 4th of March, 1866, and Charles Hoare ran a race in Te Awamutu in December 1865. So it looks like this photograph was probably taken around about Christmas or New Year, 1865-66. Now, if we look at this photograph here, which is of the general store, bakehouse, and post office at Drury, whether captured by chance or design, this one also features a poster for CB Hoare photographer. And my guess is that it was taken at the same sort of time. By 1868, Charles and his family were in Tahiti. Wouldn't we all like to be in Tahiti? Where Charles opened photographic rooms in Papeete. And he seems to have disappeared around 1876. And in 1879, his wife, who's now referred to as La Veuve Hoare, pardon my French, or the Widow Hoare, received a wooden packing case of photographic material redirected from San Francisco. The implication was that this was Charles's effects after his death, but it might well have been just photographic materials being imported by his wife, Sophia, who was now running the photographic studio that her husband had set up. And she continued, in fact, she won an award at the Paris Exposition in 1889, which I think is the same one that the Eiffel Tower was built for. Maybe wrong on that one. Anyway, she continued the business into the early 1900s and died in San Francisco between 1910 and 1920. Perhaps I should also mention the mysterious Richard Frederick Hertz, who claimed to be a nephew of the celebrated European composer Henry Hertz. He took over John Nicol Crombie's daguerreotype studio in Auckland in 1856. But he seems to have run it for a matter of weeks or even days. He was much more of a musician than he was a photographer. And so you'll see the misspelling of Daguerreian Gallery advertising his photographic studio there. But pretty much the same, well, the next day there, an advertisement that people who are attending the costume ball can use his studio for changing, and that somebody will be on hand to make them up if they're interested in that. He was another wife abandoner, and having abandoned his wife and children in Auckland in 1863, it's possible using Papers Past and Trove, and Elifind and newspapers.com. Any others? the British Newspaper Archive. Mustn't forget that. It's possible to trace his progress through the South Island, onto Australia, and then in the company of comic songstress Annie Hall, who was now going by the name of Mrs. R.F. Hertz, even though Richard had a wife still in Auckland. they went on to San Francisco, and from there they travelled to across Panama and to the UK, and ended up in Northampton for some strange reason. I've absolutely no idea why they ended up in Northampton, because Annie Hall came from Sheffield. And then they went back to the United States, where Hertz bigamously married somebody called Virginia S. Burke in Georgia in 1874. And then he died in New Orleans, probably in 1889. Annie was still performing on Broadway in 1905, but I haven't been able to discover what happened to her. As you can imagine, if you try an internet search on Annie Hall, you just get swamped with references to Woody Allen's film of that name. So, based on that brief survey alone, you can probably understand my enthusiasm for these colourful characters. If you want to try finding out more for yourself, then there's something called the Photographer's Database on the Auckland Library's website, which might help you make a start. Yeah, there's more and more books out there about New Zealand's crazy photographers. Lots to find out still.